Hello friends, I'm Santhanam from Smart Readers IAS. In this video, we will be looking at the editorials which came in the Hindu newspaper on the third week of January. This is a continuation from the previous video. Let's go to the first article, which is titled Left Behind and came on the 18th of January. So what is this article about? This article talks about the necessity to include the age group of 14 to 18 year old children within the ambit of the Right to Education Act. So before we jump into the crux of the article, let's first look at what the Right to Education Act is. The RTE Act, which came in the year 2009, makes education a fundamental right for all children between the age of 6 and 14. It also specifies the minimum norms that should be present in elementary schools. A key provision of the Right to Education Act is to ensure that all private schools reserve 25% of the seats poor and marginalized sections of the society. But the point here which we should note is that this act does not cover the children belonging to the age group of 14 to 18. What is the annual status of education report? This article is based on this ASER report, and let's first understand what this report is. This report is based on the survey conducted by the NGO Pratham, and it is India's largest NGO run annual survey, and they do surveys on state of education amongst children in India. This survey is very crucial because the findings of ASER is widely accepted and is very influential in the making of educational policies both at the center and the state level. So what does this year's ASER report say? There are certain statistics which have been listed in this article, and note that all these statistics are applicable exclusive to the rural area in India. It was found that 14% or 125 million children belonging to the age group of 14 to 18, the age group which is not covered under the Right to Education Act, are not enrolled in schools at all. And this, note that this is a very, very huge number. And this report finds that only 5% of those children are enrolled in the vocational courses. And vocational course is important because it is only through that program that they will be able to acquire skills and get into the workforce. So these three points tell us the situation of the children belonging to the age group of 14 and 18 and are not enrolled in schools because of the lack of coverage due to Right to Education Act. Moreover, it was noted that while there has been progress made in the raw enrollment of children in schools, the quality of the learning outcomes are very poor in India. Let's look at them. It was found that only 43% of the children belonging to the age group of 14 to 18 who continued in schools were able to do simple arithmetic problems, which means that over 57% of the children of this age group were unable to do such small mathematical problems, like the division of a 3-digit number by a single-digit number. This they are unable to do. And those children belonging to this age group who are no longer in schools, it is way less than 43%. Also, it is noted that of the secondary level educated students, a significant section of them find it difficult to read junior class level texts or locate their own state on the map of India. Another aspect of the survey is that it sheds on the regional disparity in the status of education in India. For example, it was found that in a district in Chhattisgarh, 29.4% of the boys and girls of age group 17 and 18 are not enrolled in schools at all. For the same age group, it was only 4.5% of boys and 3.9% of girls who were not enrolled for a district in the state of Kerala. So this shows how different every state fares in terms of children's education. Then comes the digital divide. 61% of the children belonging in the rural areas have never used internet, 56% has never used computer, and of this, girls fare way worse than boys. The irony here is 76% of those very same children have access to mobile phones. This shows that the incorporation of technology into education has not happened. So, what is the conclusion of the article? The article concludes that a guaranteed inclusion of the children between the age group of 14 and 18 into the Right to Education Act will help in ensuring that they finish their education and acquire the necessary skills for them to get into the workforce. Any expenditure on good quality education will always result in the improvement of human capital. And only with this attitude can we reap the benefits of our demographic dividend. Moving on to the next article, which is titled Protecting Marriages Across States, which came on the 19th of January. This article deals with honor killing and the necessity for a separate law to tackle it. So, what is honor killing? Honor killing is also called as shame killing, and it is the homicide of a member of a family. Homicide means murder. So, why does it happen? Honor killing happens primarily for two reasons. The first reason is the victims allegedly or supposedly brought shame or dishonor upon the family. The second reason is the victim violated the principles of a community or a religion. These are the two main reasons quoted by the perpetrators. Perpetrators here means the people who commit honor killing. So, what are the specific reasons quoted by the perpetrators? They list seven reasons why they do honor killing. They are refusal to enter into an arranged marriage, being in a relationship with someone who the family disapproves of, having sex outside of marriage, even becoming the victim of a rape, also dressing in a supposedly inappropriate way, engaging in a non-heterosexual relationship, or in other words, a homosexual relationship, and also renouncing a faith or apostasy. So for these reasons, the perpetrators say that it is unacceptable, and to preserve the honor of the family, the violators of these norms have to be killed. What does the Supreme Court say with regards to honor killing? First, in 2006, Supreme Court said something about intercaste marriages. It says that intercaste marriages are in fact in the national interest because they will result in the destruction of caste system. The Constitution of India says that caste system must end. So having that in mind, the Supreme Court says that it welcomes intercaste marriages because that will lead to the eradication of caste system in India. Specific to honor killing, the Supreme Court says that adults are free to marry persons of their own choice. So hurting couples or summoning them before clan members, groups or CAP is absolutely illegal. But despite such rulings, honor crimes had not been recognized as a separate crime. Whenever an honor crime was committed, it used to be charged with Section 302, Section 120B or Section 34 only. 302 is for murder, 120B is for conspiracy, 34 is for common intention. So this clearly says that there is a deficiency or lack of perspective in the way how we deal with honor killings. Moving on to the next slide, let's try to understand something about Kaap panchayats. So what does the Kaap panchayats do? In this picture, you can see that the victims here are hurt and bound by ropes by the members of Kaap panchayats. So Kaap panchayats terrorize people and prevent associations based on choice. If they believe that a friendship or a relationship between a couple goes against the customs and traditions of the community, these Kaap members terrorize the victims and prevent such associations. And they do that in many forms. They demand payment from the couples. They impose social and economic sanctions. They boycott their families from the community. They divest the land or property belonging to the family of that couple. They harass, intimidate, and even murder them. And who are the usual suspects or culprits of honor killing? It is usually the family members of the couple themselves. But these Kaap panchayats also happen to associate themselves with such honor killings, and they even motivate or pressurize the families to act against the supposedly anti-traditional actions of the victims. What does the National Crime Records Bureau stats say? Until 2013, NCRB had listed 12 causes or motives for a murder. But honor killing was not one of them. Only in 2014, honor killing was included into the ambit of motives for a murder. And in that very same year, 28 cases of honor killing was reported in India. The very next year, it was 192 cases, or an 800% increase, which shows that there has been an increased awareness and reporting of honor killings. The sad fact, however, is that even though the number of cases being reported have increased, there are still a vast majority of cases which go unreported. The author says that there is a basic failure in understanding or lacking a perspective about honor killing. The lawyers usually claim that honor killings are just a crime of passion, that it happened because of a fit of rage or in an emotional moment. But the truth is, honor killings usually are premeditated. They are meticulously planned and executed. Also, not to forget the immense brutality involved in the honor killing. Sometimes the bodies of victims are even dismembered. These mainly target against scheduled caste and scheduled tribe individuals. While these points give us a perspective on what honor killing is, a sociological look at it will tell us that there is also a gender angle to it, because a woman's body is considered as a possession if she enters into a relationship with a person from another community or with a person whom her family disapproves of. Her family members think that the honor of the family is violated, and only by killing her they can restore the family honor, which is obviously a very regressive and backward thinking. So what is the conclusion of the article? The article says that honor killing is certainly a violation of fundamental rights, especially the right to life and liberty. And the positive sign here is the government has agreed to the Supreme Court and is now ready to frame guidelines to deal with honor killing and frame a separate law for the same. Moving on to the next article, which is titled Failures of Inference, which came on the 19th of January. This article accuses liberalism for generating the contemporary populism which is present across the world right now. So before we jump into the article, let's try to understand some of the keywords. Let's try to understand the keywords present in it. What is liberalism? See, liberalism is a political ideology which is founded on the ideals of liberty, personal freedom, and equality. It says that enhancing the freedom of an individual is the central theme for political action. What is populism? Populism is a political approach which seeks to disrupt the existing social order by solidifying and creating an animosity of the common masses against the ruling or business elites. Xenophobia is the dislike or prejudice against the people from other countries. Racism is the prejudice against someone of a different race on the premise that their own race is superior to that of the other person's. Communalism is when an individual decides to show his or her allegiance to a specific ethnic group rather than to the wider society. Nationalism is a hardline or extreme form of patriotism. Fascism is an extreme form of nationalism. But unlike nationalism, fascism has characteristic features like having a dictator at the center, suppression of discontent, and control of industry and commerce. A demagogue is an individual who is present in a democratic society and he or she chooses to gain popularity by exploiting the prejudice and ignorance of the common masses. A demagogue is very good at whipping up passions amongst the common masses and subduing any rational discussion. So let's jump into the article. This article is very critical to liberals, and it accuses liberalism for the current trend of populism and protectionism across the world. The first case it takes is Brexit, where UK left the European Union. While this move was severely criticized by liberals across the world, one should understand that there was a sensible skepticism amongst the people of UK about the inadequacies of the banking and financial institutions, or should I say banking and financial elites, present in the EU. People were wondering whether being a part of EU and trusting these elites will actually do any good for them. People were unable to trust these elites and they cannot find any rational reason, and they were not able to find the answer to their question, which is there any good that can come to them if they continue to remain as a part of the European Union? That was a very sensible skepticism amongst the people of UK. What the liberal failed was to accept that this was a sensible question only. So when the liberals were unable to answer, or when they were unable to address the anxiety of the common masses, the populist jumps in. What the populist does is, he says that all the skepticism and all the problems faced by a common man in UK is because of the immigrants who came to UK. And these immigrants came to UK only because of the open border policy of the European Union. So they simply arrived at a xenophobic conclusion, and it was easily acceptable for the people of UK, and that's why they voted to go out of the European Union. The next case study the author takes is climate change. A logical, factual and pragmatic truth about climate change is that if we want to tackle climate change, it requires a fundamental change in the way how we look at open market economy. We might have to take steps which goes against the spirit of capitalism towards sustainability and sustainable development, and such steps will certainly undermine what free and open market, what merit-based or free market economy is. The problem with the liberal is that he does not accept or acknowledge this fact, which means the populist is very free to act and turn the tables around to his favor. What the populist does is, he simply denies climate change. So by denying climate change, he assures the people of status quo and paints a picture of certainty and makes the common people feel secure. Definitely, he is not factually correct, but his answer is certainly acceptable to people because it is very simple. For instance, if we have to deal with climate change, we might have to move away from fossil fuel-based systems, which means we cannot use coal. But coal generates a lot of employment. But using coal will generate a lot of employment, way more than what any renewable energy-based system can generate. So there is a fear amongst people that moving towards climate change will lose them their jobs. But when the populace denies climate change, it makes them feel secure that they won't be losing their job. Had the liberal accepted that there is a fundamental change required in the way how capitalism functions, and had he explained to the people why it is necessary, people would have had a clearer picture before they made up their mind about which one, about who to accept, the liberal or the populist. So what is the exact problem with the liberal? In the first case, with regards to Brexit, the liberal never focuses on the bad inference, which is the skepticism, which means that the liberalist should have dealt with the skepticism in a sensible manner, and he should have and convinced the people that their fears are unfounded. But the liberal chose to focus only on the populist bad conclusion, which is xenophobia. In the second case, with regards to climate change, he does not focus on his own failure to draw the right inference, which is he doesn't accept that there is a fundamental change required in the way how open market economy functions. But he only focuses on the fact that populists are denying climate change, which is not right. So even though he is morally right, he loses the battle against convincing the people of the seriousness of climate change. So what about the common masses? Can we blame the common masses for siding with the populist? Objectively, we shouldn't, because a common man usually feels disconnected from the ruling or the business elite. He has many dissatisfactions and he has no recourse to address his concerns. He feels that the whole game is rigged, and all he wants to do now is to upturn the whole board on which the game is being played. So it is not surprising that the common man ends up voting for the populist, who exhibits the grotesque forms of nationalistic, fascistic and demagoguery. Objectively, the populist is certainly wrong, but the author says that the correct arguments are not winning the debates because of the actions of the liberals. Moving on to the next article, which is titled Signs of a Geopolitical Whirlwind, which came on the 20th of January. This article deals with deterioration of US-Pakistan relationship and its implication on India. So what happened? On New Year's Day, President of the United States, Mr. Donald Trump, tweeted accusing Pakistan of lies and deceit. He says that even though Pakistan has received over $30 billion of aid from the US in the past 15 years, it has not acted on the Haqqani network or the Taliban. This was a very outrageous and out of the blue threat from the President of the United States. And he also threatened Pakistan that he will be completely shutting down the US aid money for Pakistan. Before we understand the implications of his tweets, let's try to understand the stature of Pakistan. As of today, Pakistan seems to be enjoying the best of both worlds, China and US, because it is China's closest ally and it is also a key non-NATO ally of the US. China and US are not getting along with each other very well nowadays, but still Pakistan is able to have a good relationship with both of them. So with that in mind, what should Pakistan do now? One thing it can do is it can just dismiss it as an empty threat, because Donald Trump is known for his sporadic, indistinct outrage on Twitter, and they can simply wait it out. Or they can act against the Taliban and the Haqqani network as Trump demanded. But the Pakistani army itself believes that such an action will have serious implications on its own national security, and it will end up being a strategic blunder. But then what does Trump's tweet mean to the US itself? You see, many of the US officials believe that it was an ill-timed outrage, because already in Pakistan, the civilian government is very weak, and such tweets can only embolden the anti-government groups in Pakistan, not good for the stability of South Asia. Also, if US decides to withhold the aid money, which it gives to Pakistan on a yearly basis, it still may not have a major impact, because the aid money has been declining over the past several years. See, in the year 2010, this was the security related aid money, and this was the economic aid money given by the US to Pakistan. In 2014, this was the security assistance from US to Pakistan, and this was the economic assistance. So already there is a huge decline in terms of the gross aid money received by Pakistan. So even if the US decides to withhold this amount, Pakistan may not be severely impacted. Now let's consider for a moment that Trump's threats are real, and in that case, what does it mean to Pakistan? Pakistan has already started moving towards China, and if Trump's threat is actually executed, this shift will be way quicker, and it will end up being detrimental for the US, because they will lose a strategic hold on South Asia. However, there is a chance that such out-of-the-blue statements from Donald Trump will be played down by the US establishment. But then, what does it mean for the Asian geopolitics? You see, the China-Pakistan-Russia axis will invariably get strengthened. And again, that is not in the interest of US or even in the interest of India. Also, Saudi Arabia, which is a key ally of US and Pakistan, might be caught in a fix, because US might use Saudi Arabia to put pressure on Pakistan. Well, now the question is, what does a sour US-Pakistan relationship mean to India? The author says that a bad US-Pakistan relationship could be negative for India. Traditionally, India has been able to put pressure on Pakistan through the United States. So if US decides to roll back on its relationship with Pakistan, that doesn't augur well for India. Moreover, the China-Pakistan combined will strengthen, and it will push India against the wall in the South Asian region. And with the absence of a strategic presence of United States in South Asia, China is now free to perform maneuvers against India. And all of this certainly imply that a bad US-Pakistan relationship may not end well for India. So in that case, what should India do? Firstly, India should be very objective here. It should note that the US president has charged at Pakistan for not acting against Taliban and the Haqqani network, but not against the terrorist organizations which act against India, like Lashkar-e-Toyba or Jamaat-ud-Dawah. So India should view it as a geopolitical issue between US and Pakistan, and it should avoid getting involved in this. And finally, the author concludes that the focus for India should be on infrastructure development, market access, development of regional organizations, and regional conflict resolution mechanisms. It should not be focusing on such hard-nosed geopolitics, which could lead to instability. Because unlike China and the US, India certainly wants stability in South Asia. Thank you for watching this video. Please encourage us by subscribing to our YouTube channel, and note that we will be posting new videos every week. And for more free civil service examination related content, please subscribe to our Telegram channel listed in the description.